help us sing?
Sing every praise.
As we pray to our God.
Every word of
worship with one accord.
Never let me go.
I
are my one desire.
You are my desire.
No one else will do, Lord.
No one else will do.
No one else could take your place.
No one else can take your place.
To feel the warmth.
To feel the warmth of your embrace.
So help me find my way.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It is to you I give the glory. It is to you I give the praise. For you have done so much for me, and I will bless your holy name. It is to you, your name, bless your name. glory. It is to you I give the praise, for you have done so much for me, and I will bless your holy name. It is to you, Holy Father, no one like you, and I will bless your name, bless your name, bless your name forevermore.
It is to you I give the glory. It is to you I give the praise, for you have done so much for me, and I will bless your holy name.
It is to you, Holy Father, no one like you, and I will bless your name, bless your name, and I will bless your name, bless your name, and I will bless your name, bless your name, bless your name, bless your name, bless your name.
with Christina, because, yeah, I'm at a loss. Oh, there he is. How you doing, Doc? Good to see you. Good to see you, man. Good to see you.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Amen. May we all stand, please? And as we stand, I'll pray. Dear God, we thank you for bringing us in this house of worship, God. Allow us, Lord, to experience your presence this morning and to give you the praise that you are due. In your name I pray, amen. Everyone, our hymn this morning is The Great Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart, hymn number 27. Please join with me in singing. The hymn is in your hymnals, obviously, and also on the screen.
God is great and greatly to be praised. We just sang a song that said, rejoice give thanks and sing. We know it's a little rainy outside, but there's a sunshine in our heart, so we can rejoice. Amen. Amen. If you could please stand with me here, there's a scripture that I'd like us to, maybe you know it. If you don't know it, you'll remember it. Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Anyone knows what that scripture states? Anybody remember that scripture? Yes, I thought so. Let's say that together. It was brought up in my remembrance on today. Exodus chapter 20, verse 8 through 11. Let's say it together. It says, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and..." I always mess up that part. "Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." Anyone excited for the Sabbath on today? God is great and greatly to be. If it wasn't for the Sabbath, I wouldn't get a break. So I am grateful for that. Bow your heads with me. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you for what you're going to do in this service. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Do we have any visitors with us on today? Any first, second, or third time visitors with us today? If you could just wait. We have one. Let's give them a hand. Thank you. We have two. Very good. Thank you all so much for dropping by Decatur, where we believe it's greater. Amen. Did I just get cold feet? Sorry, guys. Praise and worship. It's praise and worship time. Read the screen, sir. Read the screen. It's praise and worship time. You all ready to praise God on today? Stand on your feet one more time for me. Let's give God a praise on today, this moment. Put your hands together. Give him a clap offering of praise. God, we thank you for the activity of our limbs, for the motion in our body. We thank you that we walked in here on today. God, we lift you up and we praise you. Can somebody shout hallelujah? Lord, you're worthy of all praise, honor, and glory. Lord, we thank you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We just want to give God praise. Hallelujah. We're thankful for the Sabbath. We're thankful for safety coming through this week. And we just want to give God a thank you. How many of you want to give God a thank you? Just lift your voice and say, thank you, God, for getting me through this week. Thank you, God, for getting me through the bills. Thank you, God, for getting me through everything and for your love. And how many of you know that because of who he is, he's more than able to do exceedingly abundantly all that we can ask for or think? That means he can do more than what we even think, what we even fathom, what we even comprehend. He goes even above it. And so if you believe, I just invite you to worship with us this morning. It's a familiar song. And we just want to give God praise for his ability and for what he's done and for what he's going to do. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you believe, just sing hallelujah. That God is able. Hallelujah. 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 We just want to bless his name. And because he's able to give us the strength. He's able to give us the fortitude. He's able to give us the endurance to run this race. Amen.
Yeah. We started that section with, He is able, and ended with, You lift me up. It's amazing what songs can do for us. We might forget many things' names, but those songs, you hear the tune and we remember them and what they mean. And there's a significance in each of those words that we sing. When we stop and look at the world situation, we realize that unless we have a relationship with the one who is able, it is depressing. Because when you look around, it seems that whatever we build our hope on is crumbling, is falling away. But we have someone who lifts us up, someone who is able, someone that we can come to, that we can talk with. We don't have to wait in line. As we studied in Sabbath school this morning, we don't have to wait to talk to God. He is there and ready to listen to us. He wants to hear from us, and now we have this opportunity to approach God. God, the Creator. And we know that He's going to listen. He's not going to be preoccupied with something else. He's willing to listen to us. So join me now as we approach God, our Creator, as we talk with Him. Our Father, our Creator, we've put aside all our worldly activities and we've gathered today claiming Your Son's name. We've gathered in Your name to acknowledge You, and we've set aside our worldly cares on this day to remember who You are and what You have done for us. Father, we thank You for the blessings that You've given us, for the challenges that You've allowed to come our way. We thank You, Lord. We thank You for the ability to gather and worship freely. And we know that this will not last. We also want to thank You, Lord, for the birthdays, the anniversaries that You've blessed us with. And as we thank You, we realize that there are individuals that are asking for Your intervention, for healing, for comfort, for deliverance, for hope when it seems that all is hopeless. And we pray for these individuals, Lord. They've asked us collectively to remember them and to come to You and ask that we will be able to comfort and be used by You, and ask for Your intervention. We realize that the adversary has prepared a plan for each of us, and we ask for Your protection, for Your strength. We ask for patience, and we ask that we will feel and hear Your Holy Spirit when He speaks to us. We also have, Lord, families that have lost loved ones. And as they mourn the loss of a family member, mothers, sisters, brothers, we ask, Lord, that You will comfort them and You will give us the wisdom to know what to do, how to comfort in this painful period. We pray for those families that are seeking You and depending on You and in faith accepting Your decisions. We pray in a special way for Clara Cobb, for Wilbert Hall, for Michael McHenry, for their families, Lord. We pray for the family of Edna Bartley, the Presleys, the Pierce, the Russ. we realize that there are individuals that seek your intervention, and they're mourning, they're suffering, some alone, some with what would appear no hope because they don't know what to do at this point. And we ask that as individuals, as families, as a church, you will lead us in knowing how we can be a source of comfort at this time. Father, we pray for the worldwide church as we prepare for terrible times. We pray for the North American division of which we are a part. We pray for our union. We pray in a special way for the South Atlantic Conference as it's having its 26th session. We pray in a special way for the decisions that are being made tonight and that will be made tomorrow. We pray for the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church and its programs, its church schools, the efforts that we are making to reach out into the community. Lord, we also ask for patience, for wisdom, but we ask that as we've come this morning to worship you, what we bring, our songs, our words, the message that you have prepared for us, that they will be acceptable unto you, Lord. I pray for your manservant who will break the bread of life for us. And I pray that the message will reach its intended target. I pray, Lord, that with all of the issues going on around, we will see you in spite of what the adversary might throw our way. And Lord, my hope and my prayer is that our Savior's return will be soon. And I pray that as a result of our interaction as friends, as families, as a church congregation, that your name will be glorified. And Father, our hope, our desire is that when Jesus returns, we will be ready. We will be ready. I ask these mercies in Jesus' name.
Good morning, saints of God. Wow. I'm going to try that one more time. Good morning, saints of God. Amen. Can we give God some praise in this place today? Put our hands together and just give him some worthy praise today. What a good day this is. What a great day this is because we serve a truly great God who will lift us up. Thank you, praise team. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to pause in our service right now. We want to ordain somebody, set him aside. Amen, amen. That's what we want to do today. I'm going to invite our head deacon to come at this time and to present to us the ordinand this morning. Can you all say amen for him as he comes?
Afternoon, everyone. Happy Sabbath to you all. It is my pleasure, and I consider that to be a pleasure because some of you don't know during the week my job is to teach, and I teach at a public school. So it's nice to, at least on the Sabbath day, come and deal with somebody that listens and ask him to do something, and he does it. And he does it with diligence, dutiful. So I've known Alan for not long, short period of time when you look at life itself. And it has been nice to work with someone who is dedicated to what they've been asked to do. Shows up, does what he ask a lot of questions though. But he does what you ask him to do.
Amen.
And he doesn't leave until it's done.
Amen.
And so speaking with the other deacon board members, and we said we don't think that the Lord will be displeased if he is in this ordination service. Don't think that the Lord will say, nope, not that one. We think that the Lord is okay with this. We believe that. Alan Booker has been a good person. His wife looks happy. His children, they look happy also.
Amen.
And so you look at all that stuff and you say, yes, we think the Lord will be pleased if he goes through this service.
Amen, amen, amen. Can we say amen, everybody? Amen. So Deacon Alan Booker, upon the recommendation of the Deacon Board, the Decatur Seventh Adventist Church Board, we want to recommend you, we want to ordain you today. We invite you to come, and your wife and your children, Kim and Taylor and Jaden, we're going to invite you to come and join him. I'm going to invite Pastor Jay and Elder Williams to come as well. And I'm going to ask all of our deacons, as a matter of fact, yeah, why don't we invite all the deacons in the house, would you come and join with Deacon Smichael as well and in support of your brother, Deacon Alan Booker. Alan, I'm going to invite you to come and stand with me here. Just come and stand right next to me here. Stand right next to me right here. Amen, amen, amen. Deacons, come on up and squeeze on all around. Just kind of surround. Come right to the back and just kind of surround this family. And just come all around. Just come on. Come on up. Amen. Amen, amen. Is everybody here? Alan, it's been a journey getting here, hasn't it? I know it has, and I can say that because just yesterday, Alan sent me a text, a picture, was in an accident yesterday, and you drive for a living, right? Is that what you do? So he's very careful on the road, and it's quite interesting that this particular week. So I want to let you know as you stand here today that God's got you here, and he's got you. He's got you. That the enemy is angry about this, but all of heaven rejoices. The man that you are and the fact that you've chosen to serve the Lord. And what we do here today is we ordain you, we lay hands on you, we set you apart for this sacred office, this ministry. We take that cue from 1 Timothy chapter 3, which speaks about elders and deacons being ordained. Verses 1 to 7 speaks to the elders. Verses 8 through 11 speaks to the deacons. And I want to read that to you and in the presence of this congregation, those watching online, and then we're going to have a pledge that we want you to agree to. But here's what the Word of God says. Again, 1 Timothy chapter 3. And I'm reading from verse 8. It says, deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to wine. Amen. Not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. And let them also be tested first, which is why there's a period of testing, as Deacon Smichael talked about. Let them be tested first, then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Now, that doesn't mean they can't make mistakes, but it means that they're consistently moving in the right direction. Can you all say amen? Amen. Their wives also must be dignified, not slanderers. In other words, not running around and creating mess and drama. Come on, say amen. But sober-minded, faithful in all things. And we praise God for Sister Kim. Can you all say amen? Amen. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their own households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we're going to invite you to take a pledge, and just in each of these comments, I've got about 5 of them, and you would just affirm, yes. Brother Alan Booker, you have been called to the office of deacon because you've proven yourself to be blameless, reputable,
and full of the Spirit and of wisdom. By God's grace, will you continue to walk in a manner that is worthy of the gospel?
Yes.
Deacons are qualified to be servant leaders in God's church, and so far as they demonstrate, they're servant leaders in their home. Will you continue to be faithful to your wife and lead your home in a manner that displays the gospel and the glory of Christ?
Yes.
Deacons are charged with the responsibility of caring for the physical and practical concerns of the church, so that the pastor and elders are free to focus on shepherding and teaching the church. Will you serve your pastor, elders, and your church in this way?
Yes.
Brother Booker, we have an enemy that seeks to divide the church because the glory of Christ is displayed in unity. Will you use your office, your ministry, to build unity and protect against division in this body?
Yes.
And finally, will you now accept the office of deacon out of a love for God, a desire to serve this church, and a commitment to promote the gospel and the glory of Christ? May you serve well as a deacon and thereby gain a good standing for yourself and a great confidence in the faith that is in Jesus Christ. Is that your desire?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. You've heard him in the affirmative. It's something he desires to do. And so it is our desire this time to set you apart. Pastor Jay, if you would come, we're going to invite you to kneel. And deacons, we're going to invite you to come forward. The family may remain standing. Pastor, we will lay our hands on him. And deacons, you also can touch and lay hands as much as you can, or just lay your hands on each other.
Father in heaven, right now, we are coming to you thankful and grateful for how you are moving in Deacon Booker's life. Lord, right now, we present him to you. Lord, he has shown himself dutiful for doing your work. And God, right now, we don't take it for granted for what you have blessed this ministry with, this church with, God, our team with. Father, we are complete with this man, and we thank you for placing him in our lives. Right now, we ask your special blessing over him and his family. Father, protect them as you have done in the past, as you have shown just yesterday. Protect them as the enemy tries to come and attack. Father, we ask that you allow your angels to just stand up and guard against any attacks of the enemy. Father, continue to bless this family more than they could ever imagine or think. Father, let them not want for anything. Lord, allow them to never want for any food, or allow them to never want for a bill. God, meet their needs right where they are. Father, allow this man to be the head of his house the same way how he has led his position in this church, God. Let him be the example that you have already called him to be, and help him to walk steadfast and unmovable. Father, help him to stay on the straight and narrow path, Father. Keep him in the way that you have him to go. Father, right now we lift him up, and we also lift up his wife. Lord, please continue to be with her in a very special way. Give her the support and the things that she needs to be able to stand by her husband. And Lord, we pray and we thank you for their children. Father, continue to protect and bless them in Jesus' name. Lord, we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
All right, we have some presentations we want to make. Elder Williams will make those at this time.
Deacon Booker, we've had the opportunity to work together, and the reason that I think everyone is standing here with you is because they recognize that the Holy Spirit is on you. And so as you move forward, continue to let your light shine for him, because in the end, he has a crown of glory waiting for you, for those of us who are faithful. And so we'd like to present you with this certificate of ordination and this Bible that we hope you'll put to good use.
So I'm going to ask Kim to come. And I'm not going to be two sexes as I say this, but behind every man, there is a good man, there is a good woman. So we just want to present this to Kim. As you support your husband in ministry, we want to support you as well. Feel free to call on us and all of the deacons and their wives for support as you start your ministry supporting him.
Let's put our hands together again for them, everybody. And deacons, you may extend the right arm of fellowship to Deacon Booker at this time. Again, God bless you. We're thankful for you and thankful for the entire family. Let's show them some love again, everybody. We need to get a picture.
Just affirm our elder one more time. It's no easy feat being in ministry. You're making a sacrifice. Your family's making a sacrifice. So we just want to affirm him one more time. Amen. Amen. I just want to keep this atmosphere of worship. Amen. Today's a celebration. Amen. We had someone dedicate their life to the ministry, and that is a big deal. So we want to just continue to give God the glory. We want to continue to celebrate him today, amen? So I invite you, if you so will, if you would stand as we sing our song of meditation.
All of my worship.
Loving God, we are thankful today to just be here in your presence, and we sense your presence here already. You are worthy of our worship, and as long as we are breathing, as long as we are living, we will worship you. Other folk may not understand why we worship God, may not understand why we raise our hands, why we shed a tear. But God, you are worthy. God, you are good. And so we give you all the praise and all the worship. God, many of us have come into this place and we've had to push past burdens and push past pain and push past hurt and push past disappointment. But we're here today because you brought us. And you've come, you've brought us here to remind us that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Thank you, God, for this past week. Thank you for this Sabbath. God, I just pray that right now, God, in this moment, we will feel your touch. We will sense your grace once again. Speak to those of us. We're here physically in this building, those of us who are online. Have your way now, God, we pray in Jesus' name. Let all of God's children say amen and amen. Would you put your hands together and give God some praise again for his goodness, his grace, those whom he's blessed with the ministry of music. We thank God for you all, for your service here every Sabbath at Decatur. I want to talk to you from the book of Philippians chapter 2, and I'm going to invite you to stand with me as we take out the Word of God, whether it's on a device, it's going to be on the screen, wherever you have it stored. We can invite you to stand. You're online. We can invite you to watch, follow along with us. Again, the book of Philippians. What book did I say, everybody? Philippians chapter 2. And I'm going to read in your hearing verses 1 through 11. I'm going to be reading from the New International Version. And here's what the Word of God says. Therefore, somebody say therefore. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, rather in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. Somebody says, humble yourself. By becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I want to speak to you for the next few minutes on the topic, the heart of a servant. The heart of a servant. You may be seated in his presence today. A few years ago, I was in a seminar, and it was being conducted by a corporate executive, and he asked us a question. How many of you remember a bad experience with service? And practically everybody's hand went up. And then he said, how many of you remember a good experience with service? And it took a little time, and some hands went up. Clearly, not as many as before. The conclusion may be that either we are more prone to remember negative experiences, or we often will say good service is what? Hard to come by. More and more, companies and corporations are recognizing that good service is critical to the growth and success of any company. That if you can create a good experience for people, they will not only keep coming back, but they will spread the word. Forbes put together a top 10 list of companies with the best customer service. And yes, Pastor Jay, Chick-fil-A is at the top of that list. Followed by Trader Joe's, Aldi's, Amazon, Lexus, Costco, Herb Grocery, Toyota, Publix, and Wegmans Food Markets. These companies have not only exploded and done well, but they've become household names. The question I want to ask today is, what if the church made service again a priority? And not because the world does it or to grow our bottom line, but for the simple fact that we understand service as a critical tie that binds us together. And not only that, but that our service to each other and to others outside of these walls is in and of itself a compelling witness to the transformative power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The world is in need of a true witness more than ever. Why? Because ours is a self-serving, me-first mentality culture. How many of you know that to be true today? So the question is, why has service gotten such a bad rap? Because we have confused it with servitude. Servitude, according to one definition, is the state of being a slave or completely subject to somebody more powerful than you. Service, on the other hand, is the action of helping or doing for someone else. The difference between servitude and service is motivation. Is what, everybody? Motivation. What's driving you? Servitude is forced labor. You don't have the freedom of self-determination. I do because I don't have a choice. That's slavery in the most basic sense. But service, on the other hand, is voluntary. Service means that I add value to someone else's life. I make a difference in their lives. I help them get something or somewhere or do something they want or need. And I do it because I want to and not because I have to. In other words, in servitude, I have to, but in service, I get to. Come on, say amen. Now, the fact of the matter is that none of us can exist without serving and being served. It's something we do intrinsically from the time we get up in the morning. The only person who does not serve is a newborn child, because they're totally dependent on somebody else to provide for them. But when we get up in the morning, you go to work, you're providing a service to somebody. Maybe a perfect stranger, but you're also serving your family. Somebody's got to pay the bills. Come on, say amen. You fix a meal, you are serving. You change a light bulb. You fix a broken appliance. You're providing a service. You take your kids to school or somebody else's kids. You're providing a service. You're adding value to someone else's life. When you smile, I know most of us have on our masks right now, and you can see my pearly whites. I would give you permission just for a couple of seconds to turn to the person next to you and just give them a smile. Let's do that right now. Just do it right now. And if you got to keep on your mask, they can see your eyes, smiling through your eyes. Hey, didn't that make you feel good? Amen. You just made somebody's day. Somebody prior to this might have just come in here and they were so discouraged, but because you smiled at them, you lightened their day, you lifted them up, you just rendered a service. And when we serve in the right spirit and for the right reasons, people are touched and people are blessed. What we need today is service from the heart. And so the question is this afternoon, I just want to talk to you. What does it mean to serve from the heart? What is the heart of Christian service, or the heart of a servant? And I call it Christian service today because we are followers of Jesus Christ, amen? And he's the ultimate model of service. Paul says, let this mind be in you. Let this what, everybody? Mind, or this mindset, this attitude, this way of thinking, let it be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. I'm going to give you 8 points today. I'm going to try to get through all of them. 8 points today about the heart of service. First of all, Christian service is predicated on relationship. You may make notes as we go along. Christian service is predicated on what, everybody? Relationship. Paul says in verse 1 of Philippians chapter 2, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then he begins. Let's just break this apart. Let's break this down. He begins by saying, therefore. Whenever you see the word therefore, you have to wonder, what is it there for? Amen? Paul is picking up from a previous chapter. In the manuscript, there's no break between chapters 1 and 2. The church at Philippi is facing some internal problems. They're not all on the same page. There's pride of opinion. There is arrogance, there is strife, and Paul recognized that if the state of affairs was not addressed in the church would implode on itself. And so he reminds them of their relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're encouraged in your relationship with him, if you find comfort in his love, if you share in his Spirit, then, all true service from the heart begins in a relationship. It begins what, everybody? It begins in a relationship, a redemptive relationship. In other words, I love, we love, because he first. We serve because he came to serve and not to be served. Now, it's not that Jesus did not receive service from others, Brother Castell. It's not that Jesus did not receive blessings from others. We know that when he met the woman at the well, he asked her for a drink of water. Amen? We know that there were folk who invited him over for a Sabbath meal, and he went over and he ate in other folks' homes. Come on, say amen. We recognize that. It's not that he did not receive what others had to offer, but the point is that he made serving others a priority rather than being served. And this was no more clearer than on the night before Jesus went to the cross. As those disciples went into that upper room, somebody had to perform a menial task of washing each other's feet. That task was reserved for a servant. But on that night, there was no servant in the room. And the disciples looked around at each other, and they came to the conclusion, I ain't doing it. That's somebody else's job. And Jesus got up, laid aside his outer garment, took the towel, girded himself with it, and he went around, stooping down and washing each of their feet. He served. And when he was done, he said to them, what I've done to you, you must do for one another. We serve because we are in a relationship with Jesus. Amen? We serve out of love for him. We serve out of gratitude for all that Jesus has done for us. And may I suggest to you that we may ordain, as we did today, Deacon Booker, and we ordain elders, and we ordain pastors. But you know what? We're all servants. I might be the chief servant, but I'm still a... Are y'all with me? We call ministers. I'm a minister of the gospel. The word minister literally means servant. That's what it means. The word for deacon, diakonoi, means servant. Now, it's different from the word doulos, which is actually used here in Philippians. Can I do some teaching today? The diakonoi is somebody who serves by choice. It doesn't use the word doulos. Doulos is the lowest of the lowest of the low. Doulos is a slave. And when the Bible speaks of Jesus becoming a servant, it does not use the word diakonoi. It uses the word doulos. He stooped to the lowest of the lowest of the low. He could not stoop. He could not go any further. Are y'all with me today? I want to show you what Jesus did for us. And because he was willing to go that far for us, we ought to be willing to go as far as we can go. Come on, say amen. The first thing is that we serve out of a relationship. It is our relationship with him that ought to drive our service. Secondly, the heart of a servant means walking in humility. Walking in what, everybody? And to walk in humility means to put the needs of others ahead of your own. The Bible says, who being in very nature, God. Now I'm coming back to the point I was making earlier. And that word for nature is morphe. Nature, God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. In other words, he didn't hold on to it. He didn't say, I can't give this thing up. But the Bible says, rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature, the same word morphe, of a servant or a slave. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Watch this now. Here we see the depths to which Jesus went to save us. The Bible says he was in very nature God, and there's a play on these words, nature God and nature of a servant. He was in nature God. In other words, that's who he was. That was his essence. He was verily God. He was equal with the Father. Jesus was not God Junior. No, he was not God Junior. See, we speak of the Son of God and so on and so forth. God represents that on our level so we can get it. But when the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, the literal translation is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word faced God. like two men looking at each other, eyeball to eyeball, because we are men. And God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit faced each other as equals. He was in very nature God. And this God divested himself, laid aside his divinity, laid aside his power, laid aside his privilege, laid aside his prestige, and he took upon himself the nature of a servant. And he became in verity a servant, even as he was in verity God. Do you get it? No, you don't. Because I don't. It's beyond me. And it's beyond us, the depths to which he went to save us. He did not let his position and all of that get in the way, but he stooped. Someone said it's like a scientist who's studying maggots, and they're studying a disease that's wiping out these maggots, and that scientist so cared about these maggots that he decides to jump in the barrel with the maggots and become a maggot in order to save those maggots from this disease that was killing them. That's what Jesus did for us. He jumped in the barrel with us. He humbled himself, and then he was willing to die, watch this now, as a common criminal. The Bible says, cursed is everybody who dies on a cross. It was a scandal. It was a horrible thing to die, to be crucified on a cross. It was shameful. How can we, who have been redeemed by the cross, walk in pride and arrogance? How can we look down on anybody else? The heart of a servant is one that walks in humility. It does not mean that you let people take advantage of you. It's not being a carpet. Humility is knowing who you are and whose you are, and that your value doesn't come from the size of your bank account or what you own or what you have, because you can lose all of that in the blink of an eye. But humility is knowing that I'm God's child, and because he's poured into my life, I can pour into the lives of those around me. Because I am blessed, I can be a blessing. Come on, say amen. Servant of God, true servant, walks in humility. Thirdly, a true servant looks at the world through eyes of compassion. A true servant looks at the world through eyes of compassion. The Bible says that Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, healing every disease. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. He had what, everybody? He had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. You cannot truly serve anybody unless you have a love for people. Come on, say amen out there. And is that and that love will come out. And when we serve, we have to be able to serve from a non-judgmental attitude. Come on, say amen. I was talking to my uncle, who lives in Canada, just this past week, and I said, Uncle, you know, it's good that they caught those young men who committed those atrocities, those stabbings over there. And my uncle said to me, Nephew, I'm not excusing what they did, but you must understand that those two young men belong to a group of indigenous people who've been marginalized and stigmatized and traumatized for centuries. And he opened my eyes to a different reality that led me to take a more compassionate stance. And so in every situation, as we deal with people, we have to be careful about passing judgment, because you don't know their story. We got to pray and ask the Lord to open our eyes, to anoint our eyes so that we may see with compassion. Because the heart of a Christian servant is one who sees through the eyes of Jesus. Fourthly, the heart of a Christian servant owns the mission and not the position. Owns the mission and not the position. Too many of us get caught up in the position and we forget the mission. We get caught up in the what and we forget the why. And for those of you who have departmental positions or titles and we serve in the church, let's remember, let's keep in mind the mission and why we do what we do. Come on, say amen. This weekend, we're heading out to Orangeburg, and every 5 years, we choose officers and leaders for our conference family. One of my former conference presidents used to say, one day we all have to give up that position. You either going to be voted out, or they're going to carry you out. You heard it on the news this past week. The queen is dead. Long live the king. You can't get so tied to position that you lose sight of the mission. Jesus gave up his throne. Why? Because he looked down there and he asked the question, not what would happen to me if I go down there, but what would happen to them if I do not go. He was more concerned about the mission. And you were more important than his throne. You are more important than the worship of the angels in glory. You are more important than his divinity. And so he said, I lay it all aside to come here and be born in a manger, a smelly, stinky manger. I lay it all aside so I can be ignored and rejected and talked about and spat upon, because you, I want it to sink in somehow or the other today. The value that God places upon each of us. He's willing to do whatever because of the mission. Don't get so tied to a position that you lose sight of your mission. Our mission is to reach lost people for Jesus. I've had people who've said to me, Pastor, why are you so concerned about mission? It's not about mission. I've had people say that to me. But I remember the words of Jesus. For this the Son of Man came. Go ye therefore. See, we're here today. I'm here not to entertain you. The church is not here to just make us feel good. The church is here so we can be good. The church is here so we can bring others into this fold, share the good news of the gospel. The church is not a social club. We are here. We need to keep our eyes on the mission, reaching lost people for Jesus. Should I say you don't need a title to do that? You don't need a position. All you need is a heart of love and a soul imbued with the Spirit of God. Jesus said, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. Let me also say that God does not send his Holy Spirit upon lazy or indolent folk. That is what the text is saying. He's not going to send his Spirit. He's not going to imbue you with power to do nothing. The reason he sends his Spirit is to empower us for service. You shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. Go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to baptize, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always. I am with you as you go. You got it? Amen. It's about the mission, not the position. Number five, talking about the heart of a servant. Responds readily when called upon to serve. Responds readily when called upon to serve. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 10, the Lord came and stood there calling as at the other time, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Samuel, in the middle of the night, in the middle of the night, he heard the voice of God calling him. But he did not recognize the voice of God calling him. Because he did not yet know the Lord. He did not yet have a personal relationship with God. And so God called him, and he got up, and he went to Eli, and he said, Eli, did you call me? Oh, did you get that? In the middle of the night. Oh, let me also tell you something else. The Bible says, when you go back and read 1 Samuel chapter 3, that the candle in the temple was burning low. It was about to go out. And that's a lot of information right there. What it's saying is that things were at a spiritually low point in Israel, but Samuel, this young man, this boy, was faithful in his service. What I'm trying to say is you don't have to wait for times to change. Times have always been rough, and they're about to get rougher, but this is not the time to fold in, check out, run out, hop out, flap out, or cop out. This is the time to stand up and serve the Lord. There's no better time to serve God than right now. He has created you. He has made you. He has ordained you for such a moment as this. Stand up and serve him. Samuel was faithful, even though things were bad. And the Bible says, he heard the voice of God, but he did not yet recognize the voice. After the second time, Eli recognized. The Bible said Eli perceived, the older man perceived that it was the Lord. Oh, I wish I had the time to preach a sermon right about there, because what it's saying is that we need each other, the older generations and the younger generations. We need each other. Samuel needed Eli to tell him it was the Lord calling you. Because that older man had the experience. The Bible says, I call the young because you're strong. I call the old because you know the way. We need each other. We're not going to make it by ourselves, one generation or another. The younger generations need the older ones. The older generations need the younger generations as well. Come on, say amen. Samuel immediately responded to serve God, and he needs folk today. The question is God calling me to something, or is God speaking to me? The question is, am I listening? That's the question. It's not, is God speaking? The question is, am I listening? Am I really paying attention to hear the voice of God? And when he calls, how will you answer? I hope, my brothers and my sisters, you will answer like Samuel. Speak, Lord. Speak, Lord. For your servant is listening. Number 6, talking about the heart of a servant. A servant, the heart of a servant. Serve outside the spotlight. Did you hear that? We'll serve outside the spotlight. Jesus says, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound the trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory for men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you how? Openly. There are people who will do things only for recognition. And Jesus says, if that's your motivation, then you have your reward. You're going to get it right here on this earth, and that's it. Amen? And so he said, do things without expecting a reward. Ellen White uses the term disinterested benevolence. That's where we're just doing something just because. Somebody say just because. Just because. Just because we care. Just because I know it's going to make a difference. Just because I'm concerned about you. Number seven, talking about the heart of a servant. Don't let your feelings get in the way. Well, that's a big one right there. I can spend time, let's preach a whole sermon right there. don't get up in your feelings. The Bible says in Luke chapter 10 and verse 40 that Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her, Jesus, to come and help me. Well, some of us have a Martha spirit. And we often get up in our feelings. Now, we're doing a good thing, right? Did somebody need to cook? Yeah, somebody needed to cook. But I'm afraid that Sister Martha was cooking up more than just some cornbread and beans in there. She was cooking up a bad attitude. Come on, say amen out there. And oftentimes when we serve and we get tired or we look at what somebody else is doing, we compare ourselves. Oh, by the way, that's the problem right there. When we start comparing ourselves with what somebody else is doing, and we live in such an age of comparison today, and it's wrecking a lot of our minds. And that's the reason why I have limited the amount of time I spend on social media, watching reality TV. You know, people put on there, oh, I got a new job, and, you know, everybody's celebrating and stuff. But what they don't tell you is the 100 applications they put in to get that job. What they don't tell you is all the dead-end jobs they had to hold before they got that job. Somebody put in there, you know, a beautiful picture of a husband and wife who's celebrating 30 years, 40 years, 50 years of married life. What they don't tell you is all the arguments they had. They don't tell you that. Our culture promotes an illusion, and if you buy into it, you're going to be miserable because you think that your life is in the dumps when you compare it with somebody else's life, and you start wanting what they have, and now you're in your feelings. We look at what others are doing. We say, I want to sing in the choir, and I used to want to do that one time. But, you know, Simone and my sister here and the team, I don't think they would let me in there. And for good reason. All right? Because it's not my gift. Are y'all with me? I might covet it, I might want it, but it ain't my gift. Come on, say amen. So whatever God has called you to do, do what he's called you to do. Stay in your lane. If you're a deacon, deek. Stop bothering the ushers. Are y'all with me? If you're an elder, elder. Don't mess with the folk in the kitchen. Are y'all with me today? Stay in your lane. If you're an usher, usher. Don't mess with the deacons. Come on, say amen. Stay in your lane. Blossom where you planted. Do what God has called you to do. He has you there for a reason. Make the most of it. Come on, say amen. Number eight. This is the last one. We're done. We're ready to go home. Number eight, I'm talking about the heart of a servant. Trust God for their reward. Trust God. The Bible says in verse 9 of Philippians chapter 2, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Because Jesus was willing to serve and to go to the lowest of the low, God was able to raise him up to the highest of the high. Oh, Jesus told a parable of a king who was going on a faraway journey, and he left his servants' talents or resources or gifts or abilities, and different ones had different amounts, different measurements, different ratios of these talents and these abilities. And he says, invest it and take care of it until I return. And when he did, they each returned what they had. And to those who invested and made good use of the talents, the abilities, the gifts that were given to them, the servant had this commendation. He said, well done, good and faithful servant. Watch this. You have been faithful over a few things. I don't care what you got going on in your life. It's just a few things. I know we feel like the world is upon our shoulders, and I've said that at times to Pam. Oh, honey, I'm in this, and I'm in this, and I'm that. I just feel the world is upon my shoulders. And she would say, honey, don't you remember the Bible says the government is upon his shoulders? I realize now that when I get to that place in my life where I'm that stressed, it's because I'm taking on things that God never asked me to take on. I'm shouldered because he says my burden is light. So when it starts getting heavy, it's no longer his burden, it's become mine. What he asks us to do is really just to take care of a few things. As if you're faithful with a few things, when I return, I make you ruler over many things. I'm God's servant. What about you? Are you a servant? If you're a servant, put your hands together and give him some praise today. If you just love him today and you want to serve him, because one day he's coming back. Our Lord and Savior, our King, is coming back, and he says, occupy till he returns. Occupy till I return. That means that we ought to serve and serve in the Spirit of Christ and serve Deacon Booker and serve deacons and elders and church family, because we've been served and we've been loved and we've been saved and we've been redeemed, and we're grateful for all that he has done. In order to have that kind of heart to serve like Jesus, you need to pray like David. Lord, renew in me a right spirit and create in me a clean heart. A heart of love, a heart of compassion, a heart that values mission above position, a heart for people. Our vision at Decatur is to worship God, share Christ, and serve others. And I want to serve in the Spirit of Christ, so that one day when the King comes, you know, you've heard it, yes? The Queen is dead. Long live the King. And all the tributes are pouring in for the Queen. She was a great person, great, great woman. She reigned for 70 years, one of the longest reigning monarchs of all time. Now the King, Prince Charles, now King Charles. Somebody said, man waited 73 years to get a job. But I know another king. He's a King of Kings. And he's a Lord of Lords. There's no end to his reign. There's no limit to his power. He rules and he reigns forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Hallelujah. And one day, that King is coming back with all power in his hands. He's coming back, and all of heaven will be emptied out as he comes to get his children. I hear the songwriter say, ride on, King Jesus. Ride on, King Jesus. Nobody is going to hinder you. He's coming again, y'all. And he's coming soon. And he says, I'm coming to give every man according as his work shall be. Did you get it or did you miss it? Well, we're not saved by our works, but we're going to be judged by our works. I'm coming to give every man according as his work shall be, because your work reveals your relationship with him. Your work reveals that you are saved, that you have a relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I want to hear on that day, I want to hear on that day, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Well done. How many of you want to hear well done? How many of you want to hear well done? Stand up if you want to hear those words. Stand up. You're saying, I want to hear those words. Well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things, and I'm going to make you rule over many things. God, we thank you today for the great gift that you gave us. The gift of yourself, the gift of your Son, the gift of Jesus, the gift of salvation. And God, we're standing today in receipt of that great gift. We're standing today in acknowledgement. We're standing today in gratitude. We're standing today in love for the great sacrifice that you made for us, God. There is nothing, no amount of money we can do, give, no amount of things we can do to pay you back. All we can say, Lord, is thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And then go out, Lord, and serve. Go out and make a difference. Go out and be the change we want to see. So God, we're standing here today because we desire for you to do in us what you did for David, to create a clean heart and renew a right spirit, so that we may serve not out of obligation, serve not out of compulsion, serve voluntarily, serve gratefully, serve joyfully. Bless us, Lord, with that kind of a heart, that kind of a spirit today. And God, there may be somebody right now under the sound of my voice who's saying, today I receive this message and I receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And even while you're standing, you want to say, Pastor, I'm looking for a church home. Pastor, today I want to start a relationship with Jesus, because true service, whether it's in my home, in my community, on my job, wherever I am, it begins with a relationship with Jesus. I want to be a joyful servant. If that's you today, I'm going to invite you to slip out of your seat and come down front. Give me your hand and give Jesus Christ your heart. I don't know who you are, but I'm calling you today in the name of Jesus. He loves you. He died on the cross for you. And you want to connect with this church family, would you step out of your seat right now and come? I'm calling you in the name of Jesus. If you're online, you can connect with us digitally by simply typing the word decision to 619 Decatur. And maybe you're in here, standing in here today, and that's how you wish to communicate with us. You can go ahead and do that right now. Type the word decision to 619-332-2887. Do it right now. Do it right now. Somebody want to say yes to Jesus? This is your moment. Come on now, give me your hand and give the Lord your heart. Somebody's coming. Somebody's coming. Somebody's coming. You're in the balcony. You're under the balcony. Wherever you are, I call you in the name of Jesus. It begins with a relationship with the one who came to serve you. And he served you by dying on a cross. Now, Father, as we prepare to leave this place, but never from your presence, bless us, we pray. Bless every decision that has been made in this house today. In Jesus' name, let everybody say, amen and amen. You may be seated in his presence today for a moment of meditation. Before our praise team comes to lead us out with their ministry once again, I want to share a few announcements with you. Can you say amen again? Amen. We praise his name for the time that we're able to spend with each other. Every Sabbath, every opportunity is precious. Amen. We thank those of you for joining us online as well. Just a few announcements I want to share with your church family. The DeKalb Mobile Farmers Market. They've been with us now for the last 8 weeks. This Wednesday is going to be the last time they're going to be with us. The truck will be out here in front of the Crest Center at 12 noon. And we want to thank Sister Shanette Jones for coordinating that. Come on, say amen. We want to remind you that our Wednesday evening small group Bible study continues. We're going to be finishing up that book, Get Unrealistic, by Pastor Debler Snell. If you haven't gotten that book, I want to make this final appeal for you to grab a hold of it. It has been a truly life-changing experience. We mentioned it earlier, and we want to remind everybody that this evening and all day tomorrow, the South Atlantic Conference will be meeting for its 26th constituency session in Orangeburg, South Carolina. So all roads lead there. Over 1,400 delegates from around our conference will be there. And so we're asking our church family to remember this weekend in your prayers, that for traveling mercies for everyone, and that God's will be done. Amen? Amen. So please remember that in your prayers. Also, we want to remember the Davis and Thomas family in our prayers. Elder Elizabeth Thomas lost her mother, Elizabeth Davis, last Sunday. And so please remember the Thomas and Davis family in your prayers. More information will be forthcoming about the memorial service. Also, we have some folks celebrating birthdays today. Amen? And I want to give them a shout out. I'm wondering if any of them are here today. Brentnell Baker, are you here, Brentnell? Nathaniel Higgs, Dr. Higgs, are you here today? And Giselle Webster. All right, let's give them all a shout out. Wish them a happy Sabbath birthday. At a count of 3, 2, 3. Happy Sabbath birthday. All right, if you have Brentnell's number, Dr. Higgs' number, Giselle's number, give them a call, give them a shout out. Wish them a happy birthday today. Love on them. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. Well, let's look to the Lord to be dismissed. I think I've hit hopefully everything that we need to talk about today. Would you stand as we look to the Lord to be dismissed once again? Now may the grace of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the communion of the saints, be with you now and forevermore in Jesus' name. Let everybody say, amen and amen. You may be seated in his presence.
Sabbath Decatur, you are officially dismissed, but you are more than welcome to continue worshiping with us.
man. You've been too good, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Said, Lord, you're worthy of the glory.
Of the glory.
And the honor.
And the honor.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop praying.
Can't stop praying.
Can't stop praying.
Can't stop praying.
You've been too good, Lord.
Been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Said, Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy.
Of the glory.
Of the glory.
And the honor.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop praising.
Can't stop praising.
Can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
You've been too good, Lord.
Been too good, Lord.
So I